Peace and love, family. This is Talk Black to Me, and I'm your host, Brother Haru Bey. This is my co-host here, Sister Freedom. How you doing this evening, sister?
I'm fine. Good. Tired, but I'm here and I'm fine.
Good. Well, tonight, family, we have a treat for you. We have one of the members of the new Black Panther Party for the Fight for Freedom. Brother, can you introduce yourself?
I am Imam Akbar Abdullah Kareem Bilal. I am the National Minister of Justice for the New Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. The leadership in the chairman's office of the national chairman, Hashim Etnaton Nzinga. We are the Cubs and we stand in the legacy of the most honorable Dr. Khalid Abdul Muhammad and one of our finest freedom fighters ever.
I'm talking about.
We are thankful for that, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, oh, Brother Khalid, that was one of my favorite freedom
Mine
fighters.
Too.
Sorry, the brother passed, but his legacy still lives on.
Yes, sir.
Right, so. I remember the first time I ever heard his voice, and it rang in my ears like thunder, and he kept saying, come together, children. He was at a Savior's Day that Minister Farrakhan was having, and he kept on saying, come together, in that strong voice. Come together, Black children, come together. And it just, I didn't know who he was at that time. And I kept saying, who is that man? And then later on, I found out it was Dr. Khalid Muhammad.
Praises be to Allah.
I love him.
Yes, we love him.
Yes. I want to ask you, how did you get the new Black Panther Party started?
Well, in the city of Dallas, Texas, there's a brother by the name of Aaron Michaels, and he had a partner by the name of David Foreman, and they were having some trouble there with, I guess, the blight situation, influx of drugs, and probably in particular in the era of time of the advent of the crack cocaine era. And it started, I don't know which city, but I saw it in Washington, the orange coat, the orange hats, and those were citizens who would go out in the evening and address some of the blight in the community and some of the problems, those that were hanging out for perhaps a borderline and actual criminal activity in the Black community. And in their plight, they organized with the orange hats and the orange coats. If it was raining, they would have on orange raincoats. And so, as time progressed, they began to address some of it, and I think they may have moved a few out, but that was Monday and Tuesday. When it got Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, well, they've started, they were gonna be packing some iron there in the drug slinging community. And they said, how are we gonna address this now that we got the orange coat and we out there unarmed? We're the only soldiers on the battlefield with no goddamn pistol. And so we said, well, why don't we just call up the Black Panther Party and maybe they'll tell us how to get ourselves armed. Because they said, arm yourself, what? Or you harm yourself. And they made a few phone calls and they found there was no Black Panther Party to either join or support or to call to the aid of the Dallas community. So they said, well, rather than come in conflict with the original Black Panther Party, we will be the new Black Panther Party.
Okay.
And that's what started with Brother Aaron Michaels and Brother David Foreman of Dallas. And eventually, the Honorable Dr. Khalid Abdul Muhammad was soldiering in the Nation of Islam, bringing black, the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and had teamed up with the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan and began to practice more of the teachings of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and they went on to rebuild the Nation of Islam. So much of what you see today that is called Nation of Islam was some of the work of that supreme captain, that brilliant drill sergeant, that great leader and field general, and our great hero and Black power general, the prince himself, the Most Honorable Dr. Khalid Abdul Muhammad. So what you see in the new Black Panther Party, and what some refer to as even the new Nation of Islam, behind the teachings of the most honorable Elijah Muhammad mm-hmm. was the work of the honorable Dr. Khalid Abdul Muhammad, who was mentor to a college student growing up, today known as Dr. and Attorney Malik Zulu Shabazz, mm-hmm. one of the A student yes. of the honorable Dr. Khalid Abdul Muhammad, mm-hmm. and as well a student under the honorable Elijah Muhammad, and again a student under the honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Mm-hmm. So with that, the team and the network grew and took on new life with the honorable national chairman, our very first general minister, meaning he had earned his 5 stars, mm-hmm. the honorable Hashim Eknaton Nzinga. And Eknaton was the one, you know, that gave him most of the trouble mm-hmm. long before Moses and Abraham. Mm-hmm. Eknaton was telling me, why don't you just go on with the concept of one God, huh? And so all of that has been in the history of the new Black Panther Party in that formation, mm-hmm. in that the original Panther Party, which you know Bobby Seale, which you mm-hmm. know the name Huey P. Newton,
yes,
and you've heard of the name Fred Hampton and all of those, the Honorable H. Rapp Brown, the Imam Jamil Abdullah Alameen, a great hero for all Black people, for civil rights, for Black rights and human rights. He went into revolution by the book. So he is acknowledged as a hero, along with a man you call Stokely Carmichael, mm-hmm. or the one they talk about most of the time, Dr. Kwame Ture.
Yes.
Who was spoke of very strongly by our political.
Out there.
The first phrase of the Congressional Black Caucus, led by an honorable doctor and a man forthright called Adam Clayton Powell, who spoke of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and Dr. Kwame Ture as those that he was Stokely, but he would acknowledge Malcolm X. He would acknowledge the honorable Stokely Carmichael, as well as A. Philip Randolph and many others that came with the Black Power movements that we will call some of the first Black activists, and the strong activists would usually unite around Malcolm X or somewhere relate to the most honorable Elijah Muhammad. And those legacies were in place, which brought in Dr. Khalid Abdul Muhammad, and he established his own legacy in due time. And today we are the cubs of the honorable Dr. Khalid Abdul Muhammad,
wow.
representing his legacy. Live, and you know, ain't a damn thing Memorex when you get live. Black power, we put a black fist up.
That's
black
right.
power.
Put it up.
Black power. We.
Black power.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, excuse me. Now, what chapter are you from?
I am from the Washington metropolitan area,
okay.
and the Washington, D.C. region, and I represent the Mid-Atlantic region, but I am the National Minister of Justice.
Okay.
And my previous Minister of Justice was Honorable Doctor and Attorney Malik Zulu Shabazz,
okay.
in the same network of Black Panther leadership and a strong legal team. In fact, some of the most brilliant legal minds that I have had a witness or an opportunity to witness, we will find in the legacy and the spirit of Doctor and Attorney Malik Zulu Shabazz.
Right.
And he was definitely a Minister of Justice, going up against Rudy Giuliani several times mm-hmm. and winning several times, going to civil court against a cracker by the name of Frank Wolf, Frank the Wolf, mm-hmm. who led a team to cause Republicans mostly went after the new Black Panther Party for voter intimidation, especially in Philadelphia. And that was counterpunched by a brother by the name of Eric Holder, and then supported somewhere in the regime of the President Barack Hussein Obama, mm-hmm. and we were able to defeat them in federal civil court. And you will see some of those photos online on our Facebook line as well as Twitter, and just going around the nation in this hour. But as we address that, we're coming to the concept of gentrification in Washington, D.C.,
yeah.
and mm-hmm. as well addressing those young children, and especially our young girls who have disappeared in the Washington mm. metropolitan area. So we know
that. I heard about that. What are y'all doing about that?
Well, the new Black Panther Party for Self-Defense immediately went into action to organize, especially against gentrification. And in that spirit and in that same breath and that same hour, the case came out that maybe 14 to 15 young girls mm. had disappeared. So I'm trained in social work and trained in mental health, and had ran the absconders, means to run away, the absconders unit of Washington, D.C. for 7 years. And that is returning young girls, especially, and even young boys, back to their mothers and fathers. Mm-hmm. Some homes in D.C., they have no mother and father, so some to the foster parent. Some of the baby girls that burn up both aunts, mm-hmm. burn up mm-hmm. both grandmothers, burn up all the grandfathers, mm-hmm. just went through the whole family and have rejected in 3 or 4 foster homes. And that's somebody, you say, that's out there. And that's one phase. Right. But then others are lured in. Those are the girls that sometimes set up our baby girls. Mm-hmm. They got some pimp or some player or somebody posing mm-hmm. as a boyfriend mm-hmm. and will lure our young innocent girls into the trap. And once they get in the web of the net, it's difficult to get out.
To get out.
Because they use the trap. The cheese calls some cash money. And the other, the cracker they use is some drugs or some sex or some other thing that's exciting for the first few rounds, but then they find they're in too deep, is that right? And so that's where we have found our young girls, in too deep.
And seeing those are the type of things that us as men, because we are the protectors of the women and the children, to go in and weed out these organizations or these pimps and these lures, weed them out and handle them.
Yes, sir.
Because, you know, the Black Panther Party, when they first started, when Bobby Seale and Brother Huey Newton started, the media tried to portray them as a radical group.
Right.
When mm-hmm. when we fight for our freedom, then it's frowned upon, or we're radical, or we're extremists. But everybody else can fight for their freedom. They're patriots. Yeah. So we need to stop listening to that.
That's
we need
true.
To start taking care of our own. So I'll tell the people, if you want to join the Black Panther Party, the ways you can join it, or if you want to contribute to the funding, you know, let the people know how you can join, how you can be part of the chapter, or any chapters near surrounding areas or whatever state that you're in.
Yes,
just let them know if they would like to join.
East Coast representative, as we acknowledge the Honorable Huey P. Newton and the work of Bobby Seale and all of those of the original Black Panther Party, mm-hmm. the legacy established, the patterns and programs of the original Black Panther Party, from the newspaper to the breakfast and lunch mm-hmm. programs,
right.
the clothing program.
Even the WIC program.
And the WIC right. program right. itself.
Mm-hmm. They were made to appear that they were a radical group.
Yeah.
They had people afraid of the Black Panthers back then.
That's right.
Afraid.
And I
personally think they should be afraid of them to now.
The fear factor was that the Black man would free himself mm-hmm. using the concept of the original Black Panther Party to establish vocational trade. Mm-hmm. Remember, when you and I were baby boys and baby girls, there was always, in every Black school, had the home economics for the girls.
Mm-hmm.
Who suggested in the Black community take out home economics? We had some wood shop.
Yep. Right.
Somebody made sure you had mathematics.
Auto mechanic mm-hmm. shop.
In fact, when George W. Bush accused the Chinese of stealing secrets, the Chinese ambassador conducted a press conference and said that these things are not secrets. We've had this all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And I had the opportunity to pose a question. And the Chinese ambassador pointed at me. He said, no, you are the one. He was talking about Black people, but pointing directly at me. He said, you started the Chinese Industrial Revolution.
Mm-hmm.
We went to the STEM program, to science,
yes.
technology, engineering, mathematics, and mathematical and mechanical engineering was some Dr. George Washington Carver
mm-hmm.
and all of those great ones who told you there was no culture before agriculture
right.
and knowing how to use the seed and how to grow our own food.
Mm.
And those things were taught and drilled in the Black community. We didn't need aid from the white man. We had excellent schools in
exactly.
the Black community,
mm-hmm.
in many, many communities. And I grew up in an excellent Black school.
And you can see, I've lived it yeah. right now in my time. I would never thought that I lived at a time that I watched it crumble.
Mm-mm-mm.
I watched all the businesses just go away. and who came in and now owns all the business. The schools don't have anything left in them.
That's right. And there was something there to acknowledge. In Washington, D.C., they have demolition many schools. I'm the first black engineer under the Honorable Marion S. Barry in Washington, D.C. And someone came out in the neighborhood saying that they're going to demolition a school. And then they put in place of that school a playground, put basketball goals. Another one, they demolition the black school.
It's
and
like
put in place a dog park, a dog. They say I was responsible for building the first dog drinking fountain for the dog, a dog electronic pooch for the dog. And I went into the neighborhood.
Why wouldn't they want their sister or their brother?
And they said that this school was mowed down, and it was supposed to be the Marcus Messiah Garvey Park. But they changed it to a dog park. The white man got into D.C. so much gentrification is stacked up that he got power enough to shut down the school. And every nationality of people came as I was an engineer in that park. No one asked, where are the displaced black children? They wanted to know, where is the dog drinking fountain? Where is the dog poop park? Where is the this and the that? But no one said, where are these black displaced children? Where are they attending school today?
Well, see, that was
because they didn't give a damn about education in the black.
Right. Well, see, but when we were had our own communities,
yes,
we were educating ourselves.
Yes, sir.
And we were so much better, because when they started the busing program, that was a way to dismantle the black school and then have the black children going to the European schools where they could become miseducated.
When they interrupted that pattern, when they saw the brilliance in Dr. Ben Carson, the brilliant surgeon in the heart and other veins in medicine, should be exploiting medicine and going on to great heights, taking the whole medical community to another level. They got him managing the housing, urban development. Has no idea of what's going on. This is how the white man and the white woman, the white man, the devil himself, and the white woman, the she-devil, teach their children that they deserve a part. If you got a shoelace factory, then he's trying to get stocks and bonds. He's got to get a Kardashian on the first one with the hook shot. And all of these things got to go down, and they teach that they deserve a part of your little pants and suit factory, and part of you got a little furniture making operation. The white man feels he deserves to have a part. Look how they have sold us the idea that some African king has sold you out of Africa.
See, I'd never
and all believe, of it. We could never believe that.
I never believed
and
that.
Repopulate the whole North America
exactly.
Through a slave ship.
Right.
It's an impossibility to bring 50 million black people
physically
on
impossible.
A goddamn slave
especially,
ship.
Who taught especially us that? When the technology back then was, there was no technology.
They tell you that lie
exactly.
to cover up the first bacterial warfare when the white man came to the original people of North, this is not North America, but just the continent here. I'll call it just the continent for this conversation. But when they came to this continent, they said, we just want to hunt the buffalo and plant the corn. And the original people said, no, we don't want your kind here. We heard about the gringo, bad man, no good. He speak with forked tongue. As the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, a master of the deception, the original man said, he speaks with a forked tongue. I mean, he's lying on this side of the tongue and then trying to tell you something to deceive you with the other side of the tongue. He was a master of technology. And he went to practice it, and he said, y'all, come on, it's getting colder down here. We're going to need to hunt a few buffalo, just a few buffalo, and just give us a few ears of corn, and we'll go on our way. And oh, he lured him in. He said, well, hunt your buffalo right there, plant your corn here, and go. That's what the order of the business, where I grew up in Jamestown, right there where the white man was deceiving the original people.
Right.
And I'm just here to tell you straight up. He said, well, you guys, what we'll do is just lend you a few of these blankets we had prepared. And these
and
blankets.
If you just sign over.
Yeah, just sign over. Come
sign
over our
over.
Way. But what they had neglected to tell the people is that the blankets were laced with smallpox, bringing the first bacterial warfare to this particular continent. And the bacterial warfare, from every historian's account, said wiped out millions with an S. Those are our original crossover artists, the original Moroccans and those great explorers from Africa who had already went across the 196,940,000 square miles of the planet Earth. Black power.
And they've been making that trip long before the so-called transatlantic slave trade.
We've been telling you your ancestors sold you out.
No, I never bought anything to Africa to trade, to buy, sell, or trade. Exactly.
He came to steal the natural resources, the mineral resources. And certainly there's evidence that he came to steal the human resource as well. Mm-hmm. That's true.
Because we are living in an imperialistic government. Because imperialism means you steal resources from other places and to parlay that into wealth. That's the type of government that we live in. Yeah. Because the European came, crawled out of a cave, never had a culture, and if it wasn't for the Moors over in Europe, they would have wiped themselves out because they didn't know how to, bathe, they didn't know how to purify water. They didn't even know how to cook. They were living like savages.
That's true.
So if it wasn't for the Moors, because they almost wiped themselves out with the bubonic plague. And then they taught them where the corral came from, because they were living with animals. So they put the animals in a corral instead of having them running around and sleeping with you and everything they did, because they were living like savages. But if it's like I said, if it wasn't for the Moors, they would have wiped themselves out a long time from diseases and everything else that they brought over here. And then, like we were talking before, the European is the most brutal, savage race known to existence. Because even before they came over here, when they were over there fighting back in the medieval times, because I was talking to one of the brothers before, and just look at the weapons that they used. Big, giant axes and double-edged axes. And then the other weapon with the ball with the spikes protruding out of it. Now, what kind of mind would you have?
To make something like
that. To think of a weapon like that, let alone bash somebody in the face with it. But yet they want to tell you how civilized they are.
But let me stop you, because both of y'all, I just feel so blessed to sit in the middle of these two knowledgeable great gods, kings. Now, I'm going to have to excuse myself for a moment.
Yes.
Okay, so which means Talk Black to Me is going to take a small break and come back. This is exciting.
Black power.
We have another member of the Black Panther Party who was supposed to be here tonight.
Yes, ma'am.
And I believe that he may be here, so we're going to take a break, and we'll get right back at you. Right black at you.
That's right. We'll be right black.
Peace.
Peace. Walaikum salam and black power.
And go ahead.
I hear you on that, too. This is I hope,
but we can't get like that on camera now.
Exactly. Right. But you know where
we're
I'm going with
this. We're in a heated discussion here.
That's what I'm about.
Okay, we have the new Black Panther Party here. One of the other members, can you introduce yourself, please?
My name is Hebel. I'm the Eastern Regional Chairman in charge of the Eastern Regional Chapters of the New Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. I'm here with my national official. He's in charge of the Department of Law and Justice. His name is Imam Akbar.
Right. We met him in the first half of the show.
Yes.
You're coming from where?
I'm coming from New York.
And Imam Akbar, where are you from?
Washington, D.C.
That's right. I think we asked you from the beginning. Okay, everybody know I am one of the hosts. I'm Sister Freedom. I am with my co-host, which is Brother Haru. So we're going to continue on with the show, because during the break, it's been so much discussion. So we're going to discuss some things with our listening audience, our family. Okay. Mm-hmm. How can the new Black Panther Party help the members and the community, Wilmington, Delaware? We have a lot of killing just today. Just today, two people were shot.
Mm-hmm.
What can the new Black Panther Party do for us?
Well, firstly, Sister, our national chairman, Hashim Nzinga, he is in the process of right now of having a Stop the Killing tour.
Oh, okay.
And this Stop the Killing tour is where he want to travel around to those type of areas where crime is prevalent and violence is prevalent, to be able to get a message that we do not need to be killing each other, we need to be healing each other. Mm-hmm. And he also wants to promote it whereas education is supposed to be the ones that's supposed to be teaching us how to fix these problems instead of being violent about dealing with each other in our matters that leads to that. Mm-hmm. Also, we also want to build local chapters where we can establish neighborhood patrols and things of that sort to be able to teach people how to police themselves and not have to always be determined on outside forces and outside factors to come in, which usually come in after the fact anyway. Mm-hmm. So if you always have somebody here that already have boots on the ground, that we can be conflict resolutioners to revolutionaries to each other. You see what I'm saying? You want to add to that, sir?
Yes, sir. Well, Brother Haru earlier spoke of the situation between the imperialists and the pilgrims. The old Cracker Pilgrim came with a very peculiar brand of imperialism. And Dr. King said that these imperialists had killed baby girls in the church because we had failed to activate when he is the one who has commanded us to activate it, mm-hmm. commanded us to mass protest against the devil, against the white man for his wicked rule mm-hmm. and his wicked laws and enforcement of a law. As we know, on these slave ships, when we went to Jamestown, we saw these replica ships and the restoration of these ships. Mm-hmm. I have been blessed to be a shipbuilder. And when I tracked Charlotte, North Carolina, there's a man named Murray there. And when I tracked Ferguson, I didn't bring my I Love Ferguson sign with me, but Ferguson McCullough was there. Both of their family, when you trace the genealogy of Murray and the genealogy of McCullough, we found that both of them, their family led directly to the building. Think of the diabolical mind. Who would come up with the craft? Who would come up with the idea, the architectural design, the structural design to put together the building of a slave ship? Huh? Who would do this other than the devil himself?
Mm.
That would think of an idea. Then think about this. Think over these things. Who would actually carry out the construction and building of a slave ship where you and you match together in your own waste, in your own feces, in your own sweat and labor and spit and disease and
what
flu
kind of
and pneumonia and all the smallpox that they could put together in the bacterial warfare that they did? All this man has been evil and corrupt from the very beginning. Never intended to buy, sell, and trade with Africa. Never intended to exchange mineral and natural resources. He came to steal the mineral resource, mm-hmm. to steal the natural resource. And it's shown up there's a preponderance of evidence that he came to steal the human resources of Africa.
Mm-hmm.
Even to this side, we're down in the mm-hmm. black neighborhood. You just got a little shoelace. He want to know the stock bond number. Well, make a little app where he can mm-hmm. get a percentage of your shoelace business. Want a part of everything black.
Yes, everything.
Michael and Jackson. Want Janet Jackson breath. Michael's nose is skin. Oh, can you give a little more, Michael? Can you give a little more, Janet? And all black men. Brother Hebel, do you have a little more that you can give? Brother Haru, our beloved sister Freedom, can you give a little more? We don't want it all. Just give a little more.
Well, you know, I was thinking, I think the greatest tool to teach our people on why we're in the position is the Willie Lynch chip. Teach the people every sentence. Me and Haru, one day, remember we had it on our show when you was reading part of the Willie Lynch?
Right.
That whole letter tells you how you got in the position that you're in. It's like if we can engrave this in the minds of the people mm-hmm. on how it happened, how you are being like a robot, you know, mentally being trained to do these things to each other. You know what I mean? I think that is a great piece. If I could just pass it out to everybody and say, read this, you wouldn't be killing your brother.
But remember something, Sister Freedom.
Uh-huh.
That letter started off where? It started off in the Caribbean.
Yes, it did.
Right. Mm-hmm. So we have to ask ourselves, if it did start off in the Caribbean, then how come our Caribbean brothers and sisters were able to be able to keep certain portions of their traditions and their folkways intact?
Mm-hmm.
See, because in the Caribbean, they don't have the same problems we have.
Well, if we was never over really in Africa, we would have never had those ways and traditions anyway.
What do you mean when you say that?
What I'm saying, if the people, the Aboriginal people that was on these lands, they had their own ways and traditions.
Yes, ma'am.
Just like over in Africa, they had their own. There was, just like it says in the Quran, Allah made different tribes.
Made up of some tribes and families that we should know each other.
From
yes.
Each other.
Yes.
You understand? Yeah. Uh-huh. So there's different cultures, you know, for different parts of the world from where you come from.
Okay.
So we may not have even known those traditions.
We have, because remember, this was all one landmass at one time until it came together during the continental drift.
This is true, but in every tribe there may have been a different form of culture.
That I agree with.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, I do.
So, you know, what we do now, you know, we evolved into this. Because I can remember, I'm not going to tell y'all my age. Mm-hmm. That's not happening.
Okay.
But I can remember a lot of things that happened with my grandmother that's not happening now.
Okay.
One Sunday dinner. It's a whole bunch of things that we did then that we don't, you know, that we don't do now.
Okay.
So what I'm saying is cultures, you know, we need to get back to something. I'm just saying the Willie Lynch tells you how you got in the position.
Right.
It tells you why, it goes so deep as to tell you why the black woman would appear to be disrespectful, mm-hmm. or she would appear to be overprotective. How she and why she's that way.
Well, in the course of us establishing chapters all over the United States and in East and in what they call Africa today, we hold political education and political science classes, and we have suggested reading. So the Breaking the Chains of the Willie Lynch and the Willie Lynch is part of our suggested reading.
Okay.
So when we have these political education, political science classes, we will be able to get that across to the people so we can be able to give them the medicine that they need to break away from the post-traumatic slavery syndrome or the Willie Lynch or whatever, the Stockholm syndrome or whatever they're into.
The only reason why I'm saying it, because everybody always uses Africa as the main source of where everything, I'm not even going back into, you know.
Well, why would you, why would you?
Let me finish what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. Everybody always uses Africa, but I talk to a lot of Africans.
Okay.
Okay. Who have no knowledge of self.
Absolutely.
They have no knowledge of their own country. Like they have no knowledge at all. Mm-hmm. A lot of them didn't even find out about slavery until they went to school.
Okay.
And I look at African movies, don't I? Mm-hmm. Constantly. Mm-hmm. There's white pictures of Jesus all over the place.
Your sister, they have been.
You know what I mean? They don't even have, they're not even holding the old culture.
Yes, sister. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but see, but that's how the European was able to come in and steal the land.
Like
we were talking, brother, the Indian would say, white man speak with forked tongue. Mm-hmm. So he came in with the Bible. Oh, he came in as a missionary. Mm-hmm. He came in as somebody, peace.
Yeah.
But yet, behind this curtain, he's waiting to jump on you and steal what you had. Mm-hmm. And see, but then there also the reason why is because our culture has been totally stripped from us.
Yes, right, sir. But that's what I'm saying. Right, if but I see, could but be that's, somebody that's that had how, the culture.
Right, but see, but that's how he was able to do that. Because if the way you can colonize a group of people, you must take them from the land first.
Their culture, their language.
Then strip them from their culture, mm-hmm. names, deities, culture, God, everything. Totally strip them from everything.
Right.
Then give them your culture.
Mm-hmm. But what I'm trying to say is,
and then you teach, and then, excuse me, then you
I'm
teach
sorry.
Teach your, tell the women to teach the children. Hmm. Because because the first teacher of the child is the mother when she is inside the womb.
Revelation speaks on that stuff
right,
in the womb.
Right,
so
the woman,
but not to be interrupting y'all, I'm just trying to say is I would love to meet somebody from Africa who had knowledge of the old cultures. That's if you're going to teach me our cultures and that's all and it's only a few that we can grasp it from, mm-hmm. I'd like to meet those people. When I look at the movies and things, everybody's Christian or everybody's Muslim or what, you know, not saying that the different religions didn't come off of something that we had in the past. Mm-hmm. You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But I want the parity.
Well, what I'm saying, sister, is you have brothers like Ivan Van Sertima, Renoko Rashidi, who else we got? Chancellor Williams.
Yes, we have a brother, Leonard Jeffries.
You have people who,
Dr. Small.
Right, you've had people who've been to the diaspora, the diaspora, and have interacted with individuals who have our culture intact there, and they've wrote books about how we should be able to make the transition from this Western thing back to our African traditions. That's why I'm saying holding political education and political science classes are very important for us our cities. And we need to set up institutions around that. That's why we have a 10-point platform. That's why we have a 9 local objectives where we work with different organizations to come in and help us educate and mobilize our people towards self-determination as a group.
And have our people teach our own people.
That's right. That's right.
Right, right. Because we don't need any European women teaching our children.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Especially our young boys.
Yes, sir.
Especially our young boys.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So what we find in every single example, without exception, that the white man and the white woman found a way to bring a very peculiar brand of patriotism, of loyalty to some European that was supposed to be over music, and another one was supposed to be over medicine, and they ignore the concept of Imhotep or Isis and Osiris and the comedic science, the Maiat, and the things that Dr. Mulana Coringa had put us into the idea of our own independent African culture, ways and habitations of our own ancestors, and connected directly to Africa to free us from the slave culture and get us towards freedom. But in that concept, there's not a real Willie Lynch character that we know and point to Willie Lynch. They teach you all about a guy named Jim Crow, but nobody knows the personality of Jim Crow and Willie Lynch. But we know there was a president by the name of Andrew Johnson. So teaches the Most Honorable Dr. Khalid Abdul Muhammad and many others that he was the president of the United States. But what many have failed to tell you that there was an illiterate. This is what the white historian, and we've even found some black historians covering up the fact that there became an illiterate president of the United States. That is a part of the cover up. And this guy, Andrew Johnson, when they tell you about an Abraham Lincoln who was assassinated by a cat, they call John Wilkes Booth. But as they told you about John Wilkes Booth, they failed to tell you that when John Wilkes Booth was supposed to carry out the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, that 3 hours later, they had sworn in Andrew Johnson, who was an illiterate cracker from North Carolina, and he came in through the Tennessee, became governor of Tennessee. Rain, meaning ruler, not as rain from the sky, but as rain from the Queen Elizabeth of the Bloody Brits. He reigned over North Carolina, South Carolina, Tennessee, Maryland, D.C., and Virginia, Delaware to Alabama. This cracker had power, and he was the one that came in and enforced and brought not a Jim Crow law, but it was an Andrew Johnson's law. And that law is still in effect to this hour, and not even the black nor the white historian is beginning to uncover so that black people can go through that communication link and free us in a manner that we'll say, yes, this is my rubber in Africa. This is my chocolate, not Hershey's chocolate, but our chocolate. Not a cracker that's good and rich, having a good year. Not a Yokohama, Continental, or Michelin. But here's what? This is young Abdul Rahman's rubber. This is young Latif's chocolate. Is that right? And then you begin to free yourself in a manner that you're independent businessmen. Not looking for a goddamn job over here in General Electric. Not looking for a space at Best Buy, but now having your own, making your own goddamn Best Buy. And that's the way we need to think, independent of this cracker, out of this gentrification. And we will find a way when we collectively and we go in solidarity, we find a way to stop us. If we are responsible for our own baby girl, then we're going to stop that shit. And we're going to find a way to be in control of these things. Then we're gonna manage differently in the future. And that's what the new Black Panther
that's right.
brings the new way of
that's
doing
right.
things. A productive habitation and get the hell away from uneventful habitations right. and start a new production line of our
right.
own.
Right, like the brother.
Black
like
power.
The
brother
Black power.
Black power.
Black power.
Black power. We raise our people. Black power. Can we get y'all to go up from the heart? Black power. Black power. Let's go together. On the heart, everybody on the heart. Black power.
Black power.
That's the way we go. That's black
power. Like you were saying, brother, the political science classes.
We need those.
Especially the economic classes.
Yes, sir.
Because we need to be taught economics. Because we were taught to be consumers instead of entrepreneurs.
That's right.
Here's a simple analogy of that. And I was teaching this a couple of days ago. How simple is it for brothers and sisters who have a kitchen to make a potato chip?
Come on.
Very simple.
You know, she had home economics.
Okay,
class.
Check this out now. A potato chip, brother.
Come on.
Where you can make a potato chip. We can make a, how come nobody never came out with a sweet potato chip? Then you can take that sweet potato, you can put some sea salt on it, right? And then you can name that potato chip after your family.
Right.
Come on.
Then you can get another, you can get your next door neighbor who's very good at making muffins.
Come on now.
Right? Mm. Then he or she can have a family muffin. And then next door neighbor can have this. And then what we can all do is put our monies together. We can get a storefront in the neighborhood, and everybody can sell their stuff in the neighborhood to the neighborhood and keep the outsider out. We'll be eating everything from each other.
That's the difference that the Panther makes a difference.
That's right.
Right. Coming out
exactly.
Like Bonnie's.
That's the difference, beloved.
That's what the Amish do.
That's what everybody else does.
And then they started inside their house. Matter of fact, it's my beloved cousin.
Okay.
Hey, cuz, I'm talking about you
Black
Power. And I'm with the Black Panther Party, and I know you're going to be mad with me for not calling the new Black Panther Party. I apologize. Mm-hmm. But they here. And Bonnie's but in her house. Remember they had the chicken fingers, the nice big fat chicken fingers and fish sandwiches and all that, and made a killing outside of her home. And so she was able to open up a restaurant. Mm-hmm. What I'm saying is, if every three blocks there was a soul food coming out the house, nobody would shop at the Chinese stores
and see,
I was at Christiana Mall the other day, and I stood in the middle of the food court, and I looked around at all the stores. I was like, if there was a soul food, just a soul food restaurant with mac and cheese, green string beans, sweet potatoes, baked chicken, fried chicken. What is you talking about? Nobody would be shopping at Chick-fil-A or what is it, Chick-fil-A or whatever, or McDonald's and that, because everybody would
somebody
be in a line going outside. trying to get Minister Roberts carrot cakes. I mean, you know the nation.
Right. That's
they,
right.
They have the carrot cakes.
Right.
A butternut squash cakes,
right.
Fish sandwiches, all kind. Can you imagine?
Yeah, like a name, like a
if somebody, if just like a neighborhood family store. Would put their money together and get a spot in the mall.
That's right. Like a neighborhood store,
right.
Where the neighborhood can contribute to feeding everybody.
Just like,
and tomorrow the nation will be having some carrot cakes on 28th Street.
That's just like Tulsa, Oklahoma did.
Right, Black Wall Street.
That's how they built the community.
Yes, sir.
Like I said, if you had a barbershop, you had a car dealership, you had a supermarket, we would all send our children to your barbershop.
Right. That's right.
We would buy our cars
That's
from
right.
you. We would shop
That's
at your
right.
supermarket. And your money should circulate 8 to 9
yes,
times
sir.
Before it goes out.
That's yes, true. That is true.
Especially with a $1.3 trillion spending and buying
Thank
power that
you.
We have every
Thank
single
you.
Year here.
That's right.
Thank and you. Even their economists say, all we got
to
do is put one-third of that money within our communities and educate, build institutions where we can educate our own children and employ our own children.
Exactly.
We'll be the 9th to the 13th richest people on the planet. What are we waiting for, people? What are we waiting
not
for?
Trusting each other is a trick.
I don't. You know why?
Trick.
You know why
and
I don't buy that?
Right. It is,
sister.
Though.
You know why I don't buy that?
I want to hear why.
It's simply the fact that we go downtown and we trust our enemy. How can you go to work for somebody for a whole week for free
right.
and trust the fact that he's going to pay you not knowing anything about the finances of that particular company, right? And then on the hope that you're going to be able
to get. It's technology. It's a spell on the mind is why we don't trust each other.
Well, we've been here for
no reason.
Sister, we've been here for 398 years.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
we've been here a long time.
Okay, but we still ain't catching it. Didn't Willie Lynch say it was going to be 300 years or more? Mm-hmm. And then the trick that he played was still going to be going on. We just read that not too long ago. But, and it still happened.
I really don't think it has anything to do with Willie Lynch. I think that
I'm using that as an example.
Right, I agree. But I personally feel that there's a lot of brothers and sisters that still want the crumbs that fall from the master's table, and they don't want to leave the master alone.
Exactly. And well, the spell was there.
It's because
why they keep on wanting the crumbs.
Yeah, but because they want to be collaborators. They want to be collaborators with our enemy.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Because they feel that our enemy is more worthy than us. And he uses a lot of things to divide and conquer us and to keep him away from dealing with the people who really have the knowledge, the wisdom, and the understanding. Because think about it. Right now in New York, they got a European guy, Caucasian guy, walking around here with a sword talking about he don't like blacks, stabbing blacks. Hmm. And my whole thing to that is, well, why don't he come to a real neighborhood and look for some brown-skinned people? Because he know he get looked for first.
That's right.
He know he get looked for first. He's downtown. Let him go to East New York or Brownsville, where they have a, I'm not saying that this is a good thing, but they have a very bad reputation as far as brown-skin-on-brown-skin violence. But you know he wouldn't last 3 seconds in a place like that.
Not at all.
Yeah, so
yeah, but
you
the
have
average one of them are cowards anyway.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Right. That's my point.
So Dr. Malcolm X talked about how we have white disease.
And yes, sir.
As long as you have been convinced that you have never done anything, and then you are not going to do anything, or you can never do anything. Mm-hmm. But once you are reminded of your ancestral roots and of your historical value systems, and they're trying to teach you their own set of value systems, but we need to understand our African roots and our African value system, and we'll begin to relate to each other in a manner that will destroy the system of white supremacy that holds us down, global white supremacy. The end legacy there is that this guy, Donald the Duck Trump, who's ducking black people, ducking the issues of black people, Donald the Duck Trump is an actual social and political reincarnation.
Donald the Duck. I thought that's what he said.
He is the Donald the Duck Trump. He's ducking every issue, that just like old burnout Bernie Sanders and old hickory-headed, knotty-headed, woolly-headed Hillary. All of them together couldn't match. They couldn't tie Dr. Frederick Douglass' shoelace. But he is the social, political reincarnation of this guy, Andrew Johnson. If you study the history, he vetoed nearly the entire Emancipation Proclamation. What has Donald Trump spent all of his time trying to flip and overturn the thing called Obamacare? Trying to get all into how this man wasn't a legacy. And why don't just go on your own legacy? So they have to create what Brother on the Break talked about, create old boogeyman. One day Osama bin Laden. Next day, Bashar al-Assad. Come back with them some Muammar Gaddafi. And my, Dr. King became the boogeyman. One day Malcolm X, next day Marcus Garvey, the boogeyman. Boogeyman is Osama this week, and then they have Muammar Gaddafi the following week. Mm. If it ain't Saddam Hussein, it's the Japanese. If it ain't the Japanese, it's the Vietnamese. Well, Honorable Muhammad Ali told me that, hell, didn't no Vietnamese never call me no nigga. I got problem with this gringo. White man is
right
the only
here,
one giving me
right
trouble
here.
Over here.
Like
power.
Like
I put my fist up with black power.
Like I said,
because the white man is giving us trouble in this hour.
Exactly. Yes, because if
you
want
like
to fight terrorism, you don't have to go any farther than this country right here, because our enemy is right here.
I'm not getting on the plane.
I'm not getting on any boat to go fight anybody who's done nothing to me.
Think
my enemy's right here.
That's right here.
And, but see, nobody's fighting for our freedom here.
Right.
So this is why we need to take care of
that's
our
right.
Muhammad
well,
Ali was a hell of an activist, wasn't he?
Yes, he was.
Well,
yes,
I want to tell you something, brother. In the new Black Panther Party for self-defense, we have a position called Minister of Politics. Mm-hmm. And that minister's job is to be able to work with our local officials within the communities,
skillfully.
Right, very skillfully, and the communities to be able to get them towards working in the best interests of the people.
Right.
If we get people in places within these communities that think like the four of us,
right. Go ahead.
Then we can be able to go out here and be able to overturn anything
Donald Trump
puts into place, because it wouldn't matter.
Right.
It wouldn't matter. People would totally ignore him. People would say, look, you ain't in our best interest. We got the people in this community that's in our best interest. We don't care what you say.
Because
don't
make a difference. Because other cultures only cater to their own culture.
Yes, sir.
They're not concerned about anybody else.
They create their own circles.
And see, now our problem is we're always concerned about everybody.
Yes, sir.
We don't need anybody
to
solve our problems.
That's right.
We need to solve our own problems.
Yes, sir.
And we don't need, I'm race first. I don't care about anybody
else's race other than ours.
Think over. Mm-hmm.
You know, the Honorable Alexander Marcus Moses Garvey wrote a book called Race First.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
And he said that we should look out for our race first, whereas the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said that self-preservation is the first law of this nation. Let's get something for ourselves and preserve it.
That's right.
We need to do it.
This is what we're going to have to do.
Yes.
Because we got started actually late tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and it was a pleasure. I mean, a pleasure. Having a new Black Panther party here for the first time. Ooh. We're having two shows. It's going to be two parts, so they're going to come back.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay? So I don't want y'all to think you're going to miss anything, because they're coming back. And when they come back, make sure you contact me or Brother Haru so you can be in the audience in case you want to ask them any questions, or if you want to be recruited into the new Black Panther Party, they will be here to welcome you in and teach and let you know everything that's going on. I'm excited.
Yes, we're very excited.
Okay, because this is what we need. This is what we need to get things started. You need to know about the Willie Lynch. You need to know about the Jim Crow. Maybe knowing all these things, you know, will get your mind going, and you'll start trusting your brother and trusting your sister and trying to put your money together so we can economically win. Ain't you tired of going to the Chinese store? Don't you want some soul food in your life?
Yes. Especially in your own neighborhood.
Right. You need some mama cooking. Maybe you'll have more respect for mama.
Our Honorable Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said, put your money in your bank. And Elijah Muhammad opened his own bank. And Marcus Messiah Garvey put it all there. And that's why I wrote something called 4M Technology, based on Dr. King, based on Marcus Garvey, as Brother Head Bell is preparing to give his information so that we're here in Wilmington, Delaware, but this region, he is the man of the region, the man of the hour, and he's going to give you some powerful information on how to contact the new Black Panther Party, especially in this region. And if it goes out around the world, you can still contact Head Bell, because he's a real Black activist, nationalist, pan-Africanist, Black power general right here in his own right.
He's a forthright brother,
and we're just proud to have to be associated with Head Bell and Brother
Haru. Already
know
Big Keith is very interesting. He's sorry that he couldn't make it tonight to be here. And if you want some fried chicken, go to Walt. Stop going to the Chinese store. Go to a Black establishment.
Teach.
Okay? So I'm telling you, find Bonnie's over South Bridge. This is Talk Black to Me. I'm your host, Sister Freedom.
And I'm Brother Haru Bey.
The new Black Panther Party is here with us.
Abdullah Kareem Bilal. Head Bell gets the last word on the sign off.
That's right, sign off. We got 20 seconds.
My name is Abel. I'm the Eastern Regional Chairman of the New Black Panther Party for Self Defense.
Over here.
I can be reached at 1-347-858-2333, or you can email us at nbppbrooklyn50@gmail.com.
One more time.
Hebel, Eastern Regional Chairman, New Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. My phone number is 1-347-858-2333. And our email is nbppbrooklyn50@gmail.com.
Black power.
Black power.
Black power.
Black power.
Black power.
Black power.
Black power. Black power.